Let us pray. Oh, merciful and gracious God, we thank you this morning for coming before your throne of grace. We ask that in the midst of everything, God, you are with me and doing in me what you need me to do. As we seek peace, God, this morning, we know there's not much peace, but we know only you hold it in your hand. So I love you and I start you and I thank you. Amen, amen. In the midst of everything today, I want to reach out to all those in the sanctuary who's here. Not many, but many people are here in the sanctuary. Amen. And be blessed. What exactly is peace? Many of us have different theories of what peace means. And for everybody, peace has a different understanding. In the world today, we don't have much peace from different levels, as I said. For example, in the world, a group has gotten together and has thought that in the 3600 BC, before Christ, the world has only had 292 years of peace. I'm not sure how they figured that out, but isn't that sad? That peace and war is everywhere. And that says that means at least from the Norwegian Academy of Science, there's been at least 14,000 wars, either large or small, and over 4 billion people have been killed and property has been destroyed. And when we talk about peace, we think about this as being a real meaning of peace, as that peace is about war and fighting and violence. But in our scripture today and other scriptures, we will see that that is not the only thing. Now, let me give you the history. Here are the people of the Jewish people under very heavy, heavy oppression. They didn't know what day they would be beaten, what day they would lose their property. And all they were waiting for was this Messiah. And they were praying, when is the Messiah coming? When is the Messiah coming? And so here it goes, John talking about he's coming and he's making the way for that one that will save us. And everybody said, yeah, he's coming, he's coming. Isaiah 9:6-7 says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and key word here, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from time and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. The world we live in does not have any settled peace. Not a lot has changed since Isaiah spoke to us in the prophecies, both in one we heard today and the one I'm saying now. So constantly, those people that he was talking to had been utterly destroyed, devastated. There was hostility and there was anger. But the Messiah was promised because God does not allow his promises to go unfulfilled. Yes, the people were a little mad and the people were angry, but God said, we will take care of us. The Prince of Peace. What does the Prince of Peace mean? That meant that he would work with everybody. What has happened is we've got to the point we don't want to work with anybody in the world. You know, everybody has an attitude and they say, well, I'm great, I'm greater. Are we always fighting with somebody to get more property, more dignity? But in the world's peace is broken. Would you imagine how many million people live underneath such oppression? But you know what I think is fascinating about that? Many of them are at peace. I think some of us would say, really? I said, well, I watched a video not too long ago about happiness. And in this piece about happiness, there was one story about a gentleman who did a rickshaw. And in this rickshaw, he would run and carry people from place to place to place to place to place. I don't know about you, but people are heavy. I went to Cambodia, I did the same thing. I don't know how they do it. And they run physically, they don't have no motorbike, and they take the person behind them. And the people are not always nice to them. They talk down to them. They say, you better keep going. I'm not gonna pay you what I owe you. That's one of the things he said they do to him. And sometimes during the monsoon rains, his house floods because they're in like a slum area. And then he has all these small children he wants to send to school. He don't have a lot of money. He only can send one or two to school. But here's what I thought was so fascinating. On the man's face in the video is such a sense of what we would need to call peace. I mean, if I had to get up every day and have to deal with frustrations every day, I don't know if I could have peace the night before, but he had peace. You know what he said he had peace about and why he was happy? It's because his baby daughter is well, his family is all around him, and his friends is all around him. So he had peace. I don't know how many of us can be in poor situations like that and have peace. Well, we worry day to day to day instead of putting our anger and upsetment in God's hands and let God give us peace. Peace, from the Hebrew word shalom, connotes wholeness, well-being, security, health, and salvation. It's not the mere absence of conflict, because you can still not have conflict around you and still not be at peace. I know that for many people, they're always fighting somebody, always angry with somebody, and that's always in the midst of, they could have they're worried about money, they're worried about illness, sometimes they're worried about things that has not manifested yet, so they don't have any peace. We got to understand that there's more to having peace than the present difficulties. It's not going to be the first time we suffer hardship, and it won't be the last. We need to understand that we need to be able to say what kind of peace we need. Let's look at peace. There are like several peace, but let me look at the peace for the inner person, what God gives us. Some of us need to have a type of peace that surpasses all understanding for ourselves, which is we need to have a peace of ease. That means we need to be able to relax. And when we relax, we're at peace. We need to be able to look out the window. Many of us have been home cooped up so much, but sometimes we need to just sit down and look out the window and see the trees if we can. Those who did out here, you can see, a lot of you live where you can see the trees, see it growing, see the earth still moving around, seeing the children running around in the street, seeing people who are trying to go from here to there. And thank God that we have a home. We need to look at all those emails and all those things. And even though we were worried, sometimes we get good news in the midst of those emails. It's easy to underline that, say, Pastor, well, I don't know about that. Well, this piece is very cemented. Take it in while you can. Then you need the peace of tranquility. The peace of tranquility is much deeper. It's like in your soul and your mind. You know, when your mind wakes up, I know that my brain is like this after all this COVID. It wakes me up and says, listen, time to go, get up. And I be saying, ain't nobody there but me. But it tells me it's time. And if I don't get up and I don't go to work, I don't go to hit a church, I don't go out and start doing things, I feel uncomfortable. I feel something moving in me and saying, get up, go. And then I do it and I feel at peace again. When I get on my knees every morning before the Lord and pray before God and say, listen, cover my church, cover the community, cover the world, cover those who are sick, cover myself, God, I feel it. Oh, I feel God's presence in my life. And when you do that, you have a sort of tranquility that no matter what happens, you're going to be at ease. Then you need to know that that's an inner freedom. When everything is going crazy around you and you can be tranquil, it helps you to go forward. I remember in the olden days, some of the older people, they didn't let nothing worry them outside of what was happening at that moment. And they would just be sitting humming to themselves, singing to themselves. And you'd be saying, what's wrong with them? You know, when we were children, we said, they're crazy. It wasn't what they're crazy. They were singing to themselves. That singing had all those old time hymns, and it was saying, oh, how great thou art and everything, because some of them could not even read. But they sung those songs so that they could feel tranquil and at peace. A peace of having tranquility. The peace of what's unchanging. Now, that's a weird statement. One of these theologists said, theologists, and then a psychiatrist was talking about that we need to know that in the midst of change, there's something that does not change. When you can accept there's something that won't change, you can have peace from it. Our world has been turned upside down, and there's going to be many changes. But we know that the end of it, the world will still go around the sun. It's still round that I understand. I understand some people feel that now the earth is flat again, but I believe it's still round and it's going to run around the sun. And we know that's not going to change. We also know that God's love for us is not going to change. The reason he sent his son is so that we can have peace. Peace beyond all understanding. Peace of the love of God. And that's where we need to be at, my sisters and brothers. You need to know there's a sense of an other, a sense of God, a sense of Jesus walking with you every day. Even when you're home, just sitting there. Just say, okay, let me read the Bible. Those of us who, I know for some people say, well, you know, that hasn't helped. But you see, as long as you put a negative before the positive, you will never have any peace because you're always going to be angry. So I ask you not to do that. Some of the words of God says in Proverbs 3:2 says, obeying God's commandment and walking in wisdom infuses peace into our lives. That says that we need to be wise in what we say, wise in what we do, so we can have peace. We need to, like I said in one of my papers, that we need to major in the majors so the minors will take care of themselves. In contrast to the demented minds of evildoers, those who plan peace find joy. That's Proverbs 12:20. Because sometimes we tend to keep things going. Sometimes we cannot be happy. We're constantly upset. We're constantly mad. I constantly upset. We don't want no one else to be at peace. We want to continue to keep people on edge. You know something is negative, instead of calming it down and trying to work towards peace with everybody, we tend to like to hear the conflict because it hides us from our own inner non-peace. But I just tell you that we need to want peace. We've got to the point where we are accustomed to a life of stress and turmoil. And we think it's normal. It's not normal. A lot of our diseases and things happen because of what we eat, one, sometimes. And also it happens to be that you're stressed out. You go to the doctor, they tell you at the doctor's office that whenever you take your blood pressure, and you take your blood pressure specifically, it'll be way up here. Well, that causes a syndrome that when you see the doctor, you get stressed and you worry, what's gonna happen today? What's gonna happen today? But the minute you laugh about it or bring it down, it seems like you walk around and say, I'm gonna sit down and rest before you take my blood pressure and be at peace with what's going on, bring up some understanding, and I think it's breathing in and breathing out, you'll get peace. Peace unspeakable, peace within your own home and on your own life. We're not talking about peace outside of yourself, because if we had peace in ourselves, we wouldn't have any problem with peace in the world. But peace always is hard to get sometimes. But the song says peace unspeakable. If we get unspeakable peace in our lives, we can do it for others. If you're a person that's very calm, you'll have it with others. In my one of my other churches, I had a woman in my church. To see her, she looked so sweet and everything. And she could come into a room. And when she comes into the room, even there's a fight going on, or I'm arguing with one of the parishioners, or they're yelling at me. When she walked in the room, everybody got quiet, even me. And she would say, let's pray. For her prayer, which we talked, like Brother Julio reminded us, that prayer was one of the things that we need to do, and we could come back to a center of peace. And after we prayed, somehow we felt God's presence. And when you feel God's presence, you can be at peace, my brothers and sisters. Let's be at peace, my brothers and sisters, during this time. Let's welcome Jesus and the peace that he brings beyond all understandings. It's not easy to be at peace for us, especially in this world. But I ask today that we look at these things. Number one, like I said, is to try to have peace and tranquility in your life, because we don't want to keep it going. I say that if we don't get that straight, COVID-19 the disease has exacerbated conditions that we wouldn't normally have. We probably did not go to the doctor 5 months ago when we could have, we should have been able to normally because of COVID-19. Now we're going to find ourselves in another level of being upset. So what we need to do is say to ourselves, let us pray and do what we need to do, because we need to get that done, because we know there's a brighter future ahead of us. And that should be a peace to you, that this too shall pass. Things in the world has always went on, and something happened, and we're in the midst of it, in the midst of what I call the messy middle, maybe on the edge. But in the point of it, God, is that we need to call out to God and tell God that it's time. When we have Jesus, we'll have it all. When we accept this baby and comes to us, we have it all. We need to choose to live a life that has some elements of peace. We need to have a life where God is not on the fringe, that God is openly within our lives. Isaiah says, I am the Lord your God who teaches you what is best for you, who directs you in the way you should go. If only you had paid attention to my counsel, your peace would have been like a river, your righteousness like the waves of the sea. Many of us want peace like a river. So my sisters and brothers, on this second Sunday of Advent, here's some things I want you to do. I want you to identify areas in your life where turmoil, either outside or inside, is reigning in your life, running your life rather than peace. Then go to God and ask, what do I need to do? Is it a change of my wisdom? Is it a change of my mind? Is it a change of my understanding? And give it to God. Isaiah 32:17 says, the fruit of righteousness, which means standing right with God, will be peace. And Psalm 19:165 says, great peace have them who love God's law, and nothing can make them stumble. So I say this morning, let there be peace on earth, but peace with our own soul. Let's just keep it simple and not complicate the peace of God. Amen and amen.